Fed's going to announce its latest interest rate decisions at 2 p.m. today. It's expected to hold rates steady and vow to keep short-term lending markets stable. We're going to be watching Chair Jay Powell's news conference for any comments on an improved economy, lower unemployment, after that big jobs number that we had on Friday for the November jobs report. All right, joining us now, Janelle Woodward, head of fixed income at BMO Global Asset Management, and Brian Levitt, global market strategist for North America at Invesco. How are you? Good morning. You're going to do our yield curve pal run, but I first want to talk to Brian because you feel pretty good. That's nice. You feel pretty good about risk assets. You think even not even defensive risk assets. You think it's going to continue into next year. We used to talk about your concern about a strong dollar.
Yes.
A lot. And that's been de facto what has happened. So you're right about that. But you had some, the effects of that were going to be negative in some markets 6, 7, 8 months ago. Was it in profit margins? Was it in the economy? You thought the economy wouldn't be as...
No, so we were optimistic on risk assets. But my concern was if the Federal Reserve remained tight and we went too far down the path on trade, if we continue to strengthen the dollar and invert the yield curve, then you could have a problem. So I've been pleased. Coming into this year, I said it's going to be a year of weaker growth but better policy, and that's what's played out, and that's why the markets are up some 25-30% this year. So what they've done, and the Federal Reserve should be quite pleased, they have eased financial conditions, they've stabilized the dollar, and markets have responded in kind, as they should.
So once the Fed capitulated last year, or whenever it was, late last year,
yes,
that's when you shifted from maybe it wouldn't be as negative for overall markets.
Well, look, we've been of the mind that we're in a secular bull market. Okay. Secular bull market, they tend to last 14, 16 years. We believe it started in 2009. So we were never negative on a secular perspective. What we were saying in 2018 was that the Federal Reserve was responding to stimulus and near-term better economic activity, which caused them to raise interest rates multiple times
dollar,
in 2018.
Your worry would the dollar would have gotten even stronger because it hasn't gotten weak. It stayed strong.
They had to back off to stay. But we needed to see improvements in policy this year. We got that, and the secular story continues.
You know, you think Powell's doing a good job at this point? They where they need to be? Are they at normal? Are they on hold? Everything's good? Should we even be talking about them?
Well, consensus right now is that we'll be on hold this meeting. I think one of the things that we're watching is what will the outlook for 2020 be? If we look at the dots, we see that really the floor right now is where policy is. And I think the question, and we look at expectations into next year, the market's still looking for a little bit more. And so I think the question is, what will they do with forward guidance? How can we anticipate policy? How does it flow through into financial conditions? And ultimately, how does that translate into the real economy? So I think that's really what the story is today.
Okay. The next move, no one will answer this. I don't care when it is. Take forever. The next move is up or down from the Fed?
We think they're on hold for the time being, but we think probably down.
Down? Because most people think up because of the 3.5% unemployment, wage gains, workforce getting tight. It's going to be seen in corporate profit margins as they have to, you know, compete for workers. We're pretty low still. So, but the next one is down. Why? What happens?
I think that what we're really focused on is the inflation story. What we saw is we saw tightening too quickly, too fast, and then the delayed reaction into the real economy, and then we went past neutral. So we really have had two policy transitions this year, tightening to neutral, neutral to accommodation. And so we think that that's going to create a lot of hesitancy in terms of when we would look to tighten in the future.
Paul Volcker died a couple of days ago. So is this still his legacy, do you think, to some extent, where inflation is? Did he put a nail in it back in the 80s? Is that possible to do something that lasts years and decades?
There's definitely been a lot of structural changes in the economy that have driven inflation where it's at. And I think that there's a lot of consideration on additional policy tools. And it is global, certainly. And demographics, productivity, we've certainly imported it. And I think one of the other things that we're watching from the Fed in 2020 is what other policy tools are at play. think one of the biggest concerns where we look at where rates are at right now is there's a limited number of bullets. And if right now we're in insurance policy and we haven't even shifted to really full accommodation mode, what are the other tools in play? And I think that's one of the things that we'll definitely begin to hear more about in 2020.
Joe, it's an interesting point about Volcker, because we all grew up and were raised on what happened in the late 1970s and the policies that enabled us to finally break the back of inflation and lead to this great moderation. But since the global financial crisis, it's really been a shift towards a disinflationary environment. We've been growth starved throughout the world. So what the Federal Reserve has been learning and learned the hard way in 2018 is that raising interest rates in a slow growth, disinflationary world is problematic, to your point about the dollar, because capital comes into the United States, slows economic activity, and hurts multinational earnings. So my view is that the Federal Reserve is likely on hold, but I do believe that any additional attempt to raise, I agree. I think the next move is down. If they attempt to raise rates again, the yield curve is still very flat, and you start to cause problems for the real economy.
You think the wild card is trade too, right?
Well, look, I mean, I believe that we just need incremental improvements on trade in 2020, and I believe that businesses start to need some clarity. I don't believe that trade kills this cycle. I don't believe that trade, if we proceed with tariffs, that's going to be the end of the cycle. Because it'll create some inefficient outcomes that we'll have to deal with. It's the uncertainty that leads to the stalled business investment and weaker economic activity. So long as we get some incremental improvements and businesses further understand the rules of the game, then I think this proceeds.
You just watch the Fed, or you care about trade too? The 10-year moves on trade lately, right?
No, definitely watching trade. I think one of the things that's interesting is you look towards expectations for 2020 in terms of corporates. We're actually expecting to see earnings go up about 10%. And we're seeing the expectation is that profit margins improve versus what we saw in 2019. And so I think when you look at what's priced in at the market, there is some expectation that there's going to be a resolution and that it's going to be constructive for business spending and through the overall earnings picture. And I think the concern here is if it were to escalate, what does it do in terms of labor markets, in terms of investment? And I don't think that's fully priced in right now. And so it's definitely something that we have to watch.